You're listening to the audio production of Stumbling on Open Ground, Love, God, Cancer, and Rock and Roll. Written by Ken Mansfield, published by Thomas Nelson, and read by Brent Stoker.
If racing with mere men has wearied you, how will you race against horses? If you stumble and fall on open ground, what will you do in Jordan's jungles? Jeremiah 12:5. Introduction. Tomorrow never knows. December 1980, Hollywood, California. There was something incredibly eerie about looking down on the ground and seeing John's face staring up at me. His eyes, as always, peering out with that questioning look, those eyes that followed you everywhere, not just physically, but once you looked into them, eyes that grabbed onto you with unsaid words that screamed into your soul. I was kneeling as he stared up at me, trying to get a sense of what had happened. In the stillness, I felt as if we were asking the same questions. I could feel them unite as they dissolved into the haze that surrounded this moment. He had been shot, and the many days of his life had just drained out onto a dark New York sidewalk. It had just happened, a few long minutes ago, but I wasn't there at the Dakota on the cold cement with him. I was on my knees on the floor of my office in Hollywood, far away on the other side of the continent, sorting through pictures to put on the walls of my new music production company. The irony of spreading out pictures from the Apple Records days across my office floor a matter of minutes before I answered the phone call that told me of John's demise landed me in a daze. I was surprised at my reaction. There he was, staring up at me from a picture he had sent me a few years before when I was running the Beatles record company in America. The words written across the bottom, "I am at 3 Savile Row most days." I was confused, wedged between the joy of great memories of that exciting time working with him and his bandmates, and now, the profound sadness of this event that suddenly invaded my life. I moved back into the fabric of universal bereavement and relinquished any sense of privilege or personal loss. I ceased seeing John Lennon as someone I had known and worked with, but instead found myself staring into the face of our inescapable mortality. We're so young. Where did this come from? This is not what we do. This shattering moment was our generation's 9/11. Nothing would ever be the same in the world where celebrities once freely moved around at will. A bewildered fan crossed a line that had never been crossed before in our time. And all of a sudden, the no trespassing sign into our privileged status had been permanently torn down. We were used to being intruded upon while eating a simple meal in a fancy restaurant, which was an accepted price for fame. But this, the stars were now afraid to come out at night. I looked up from my folded stance on the floor. My eyes examined the walls and shelves of my office, surveying the trophies of a hedonistic world, gold-plated things that reflected the rewards of a glamorous life. I wondered what it all meant. What if I, too, was suddenly removed from existence? I was not a Christian then, but I began mulling over such matters. Matters of eternity. These trinkets would be left alone here without me, and I would be somewhere alone without them. Everything seemed so pointless. Having only my narrow perspective to draw upon left me completely disoriented, so baffled that I stopped thinking about it. My personal reckoning was just a flash. I now wish I had reflected on the wisdom before me a little longer. What would happen to me when I left my stuff behind? I fell forward onto the floor, crumpling the pictures in my hands. I began to cry, not sure where the tears were coming from. I didn't even cry when my dad died. I can't remember anything that happened the rest of that afternoon. In the following days, we gathered together over the phone and in person in our tight little geographical unit. Ringo Starr, Harry Nilsson, Delaney and Bonnie's manager, Alan Pariser, and me, the ragged remains of the L.A. posse of musical marauders. We went to a private screening of Harry's new movie, Popeye, as soon as Ringo returned from paying his respects to Yoko in New York. A night out on the town with old friends was Ringo's idea, and a way to get away from it all. Afterward, sequestered in a private dining room of a Beverly Hills restaurant, nobody talked about it. The subject stayed off topic for years. Shots from a cold gun became the startling wake-up call to our era that there was no snooze button to give us a little more time. The message was that it was time for us, the survivors, to understand that we had to deal with the odds like everyone else. even admitting that our rarefied air had the same germs in it that everyone breathes. The phone rings and I am jolted out of that reflective mood, out of an era when we thought we were so invincible, and back into current reality. It's another mortality call. Not John's, but mine. This call comes years later and I am looking at that same picture on a different wall of a different office and at a different time. The roles are now reversed. His picture hangs there above me and he is looking down on me as I get news about a different sort of bullet. This time, it's aimed at me. I look up into those eyes. The questions and the unknowing still remain. John Lennon never saw it coming. Neither did I. Tomorrow really never knows, does it? Only God has that figured out. Deep in the jungle. I was once told that walking is merely controlled falling, the organization, discipline, and catching of our forward momentum. My Christian walk looks like that at times, like controlled stumbling. I am on open ground because I am a believer, and yet I am in constant search of an end to the aggravating and seemingly perpetual tottering of my spiritual walk. I am fully aware that God has made the way smooth, and I have His promise that if I stray, He will gently put me back on the path. All I have to do is believe and seek Him with all my heart. I also believe that God is God Almighty and that He is perfect and makes no mistakes. I believe the Holy Bible is the inspired Word of God and that every word in the Word is true. I am totally there, head, hands, heart, and what little hair I have left. But like many Christians, there are certain questions I can't answer. I have trouble sometimes understanding how it all works on a mechanical level. I find myself puzzled and pondering over things that creep into my mind and heart, causing confusion in the core of my beliefs. The kind of things that make us lose our balance as we try to imagine what it will be like someday to walk about the halls of heaven while we're still down here shuffling around in our man-made flip-flops. I want to walk in His footsteps. I'm not going anywhere else. I've already been there. For me, there is no turning back. I squandered my inheritance and swallowed in the decadence of both the high life and the low life. I have eaten the food meant for pigs. Now I wear the warm robe of forgiveness because Jesus ran to me from a distance and welcomed me home. I drink from the well of living water and am fed to fullness by the bread of life. The taste in my mouth is sweet from the ever-flowing nectar of new wine. My golden cup runneth over, and just to be seated at the foot of His table is the supreme joy in my life. But I don't always like the soup of the day at this table. What do I do when I am served up a rare, incurable cancer? What do I do when, in the process of living and trusting Him through this trial, I am given another portion? And this time it is a mean, burning second dose of the disease. The first one was slow, and even though it responded to treatment, it's incurable, a treacherous partner to the end. I am told it could stay indolent and just sit there with minimal aggravation. Or it can decide to make its move at any time, a ticking time bomb situation where only God knows the length of the fuse. While the first cancer had been calmed down by chemical therapy, the second cancer came raging in, blindsiding and brutal, here and now, all or nothing, no time for contemplating or experimenting. Regardless of my personal resistance to heavy chemotherapy and heavier radiation, the choice was literally do or die. It was a coin toss. The treatment could do me in, and so could the cancer. But I had a chance to live, and I realized there were no other choices. I bowed my head to the reality of my situation and bowed my heart to the reality of God's lordship and love. Somehow it made sense. I just didn't know how at that time. The minute I received the news that I would be facing a second battle, I turned to God for direction. I announced to Him and myself, both out loud and from my heart, that I would never doubt Him through this trial. He knows my heart, and I know His. Understanding is not a part of the deal. Obedience is what He asks. This is a quest for deeper comprehension, a desire to dip beneath the opaque surface. As a child, I would ask my earthly father how to do things. As a child of God, I am asking my heavenly Father how this all works between him and me. I never question him, but I do wonder at times about myself. Ken Mansfield. Book 1, Bodega Bay, California, 1996 to 2002. Chapter 1, The Beginning of the Edge. December 1996, Santa Rosa, California. He appeared calm as he scanned the results. I have gone over your recent blood work, and I want to have a special lab run some additional tests. The look on his face was relaxed and matter-of-fact. I can tell it was nothing serious. He was just being thorough. He was a specialist in his field, after all. The atmosphere and mood in the warmly appointed office was very laid back that day. It was my first time visiting his practice, and though I did not know this doctor, I was comfortable there. I had been sent to see him by my family doctor because of his specialty, rheumatology. The medical form he held in his hand had to do with the results of the blood tests he requested for arthritis in my knees. In going over the paperwork, he noticed a small spike in one of the tests that had nothing to do with his area of expertise. The odd little indicator required an explanation. So one specialist was sending me to another. He handed me a piece of paper with an address and a little map on the back showing how to get there. I never worry about those kinds of tests, in part because of an old friend and mentor at Capitol Records many years ago who displayed a plaque behind his desk with a quote from 16th century essayist and statesman Michel de Montaigne. "My life has been filled with many misfortunes, most of which have never happened." I have forgotten many of the things this great man said, but the words on his office wall stayed with me. Driving away from the doctor's office, I knew it was all good. Nothing to worry about. Connie and I lived in Bodega Bay at the time, and the address on the small slip of paper was in Santa Rosa, California, about 45 minutes from our home by the ocean. The appointment was scheduled for 11:30 in the morning the following week. Because that location was on the north end of town, we decided that after the consultation and lab work, we would head into the adjacent wine country, have a nice lunch, and maybe do some wine tasting in Healdsburg. We love the little town square there, and the drive back through the vineyards and coastal ranges is very scenic. If we timed it just right, we would be driving home into the filtered sunset. The days were short, but the weather was nice that time of year. We would take the day off and have some fun. The day of the appointment came, and things were already off to a bad start. At that time, Connie was an associate director in television, hee-haw, the Dove Awards, and currently working on the Statler Brothers show on cable TV. Early that morning, I put her on a plane in San Francisco and drove back north to Santa Rosa for my afternoon appointment. This was supposed to be a fun day in Sonoma County, but my appointment kept getting pushed back until it collided with Connie's career. Nashville called. The taping schedule was tight, and it would keep her for at least a week. I went alone. Following the directions on my slip of paper, I rounded the last corner on my way to my destination and was shocked when I saw the street number I was looking for etched on a sign that read, "Oncology Center." What was I doing here? Things went into slow motion. What did this have to do with itchy knee sockets? Maybe it simply had to do with the equipment, or maybe this was the only place that housed a particular medical feature in our area. I parked a long way from the entrance, a sort of logistical denial of the sign on the street, and entered a world I had never seen before. I couldn't help looking away in the lobby waiting room as I saw pale and emaciated young people, many without hair, moving listlessly about the area among old women and older men with gaunt eyes and lifeless faces. Bandanas on women. Crutches leaning against the side of a chair where a sad old man sat. Bags with pumps and tubes going into different noses and up various sleeves. It was all so alien and distant. Scary. When I got on the elevator to the second floor where I was instructed to go, I felt such pity for these people who had cancer. Oh my God, how sad! Cancer! I waited almost an hour in a waiting room with dull beige walls and those horrible plant sketches meticulously laid out in rows.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.